Just for you.
You're welcome.
Well, good morning, loved ones.
Morning.
Welcome to Desert Springs. Let's begin our worship service with a reading of our June memory verse, Romans 12, 1 through 2. Ready?
I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Romans 12, 1 and 2.
If you would, please meditate on the verse while we're listening to our prelude. Please stand for the doxology. Gloria Patri.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be.
Call to worship is from Psalm 11. In the Lord, I take refuge.
The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes see, his eyelids test the children of man.
The Lord tests the righteous, but his soul hates the wicked and the ones who love violence.
For the Lord is righteous, he loves righteous deeds, the upright shall behold his face.
Please remain standing for our song of exaltation, Great Are You, Lord.
Thank you.
Please be seated. I will offer our invocation. Our most holy God, we ask your presence as your justified are gathered in worship and celebration. Your redeemed rejoice in our redemption and gather to give thanks and to learn more of your word, so that in our daily life and activity, we may more fully redeem the time. We are grateful for the indwelling of God the Holy Spirit, who forgives, remits sins, and blesses us in our homes and business. Amen. So together, let us confess our sins. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done. And we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no health in us. But you, O Lord, have mercy upon us miserable offenders. Please take a few moments to silently confess your sins to him. Arise and hear the good news. Spare them, O God, which confess their faults. Restore them that are repentant, according to your promises declared to humankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Amen. Shall we now joyfully sing our songs of response?
Rock of ages, clap for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy riven side which flow be of sin the double pure. Let
Please be seated. Our Old Covenant reading is two sections from Leviticus 19. First one is verses 17 through 18. You shall not hate your brother in your heart, but you shall reason frankly with your neighbor, lest you incur sin because of him. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against the sons of your own people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. And then 33 and 34, when a stranger sojourns with you in your land, you shall not do him wrong. You shall treat the stranger who sojourns with you as the native among you, and you shall love him as yourself, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. I am your Lord. Our New Covenant reading is from Luke 10, 25 through 37. And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And he said to him, What is written in the law? How do you read it? And he answered, You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, You have answered correctly. Do this and you will live. But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, And who is my neighbor? Jesus replied, A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, Take care of him. Whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back. Which of these 3 do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? He said, Well, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, You go and do likewise. The grass withers and the flowers fade.
The word of God endures forever.
Charles Garland is the pastor at Midtown in downtown Tucson. Midtown is a gathering of believers that Charles and his wife Julie, Charles and his wife Julie helped plant in late 17. And our Lord blessed Midtown in May with particularization. Pastor Charles and his wife Julie have previously served in churches in Alabama, Georgia, and Oregon. Pastor Charles.
Nice to be with you guys again. We had some good news. You know, when we came out, you guys were a big part of getting our church started down in Midtown with the other PCA churches in town. And we came with a young couple, Dan and Brittany Smith, whom you know and have really generously supported as a church. And they finished this year, into the school year. And so we were bereft, wondering which of us old guys was going to try to fill in the gap for a year while we waited on a new campus minister. And that wasn't a very pleasing prospect. But God provided us a new campus minister. We had the presbytery meeting. Marty and I were on the Zoom call the other day. Matt Eswine and his wife Sarah are coming from California. So don't hold that against them because they seem nice. Yeah. But yeah, so they're supposed to come in mid-July and try to get them acclimated and get some support raised and things, but that's really good news. So I knew. And thank you, by the way, for being so generous to that ministry. It's a big deal for the churches to be behind it. And the Smiths laid a good foundation and really hoping that the Eswines can build on that. So I'm sure they'll come introduce themselves soon when they get to town. We're going to be in Romans 13. Today, you guys have been going through a series on Romans, as I understand. And this should be the easy part. You know, a lot of Romans hard to understand. And now you're down to this kind of the instructions about how to live. And And here's the instruction that Paul gives us in the text from today. Love each other. Right. So go do that, and we can all leave now and go to lunch. Love each other. People have been saying it for a long time. Moses said it, right? Jesus said it a lot. Paul and the other apostles repeated a lot. Patti Smith famously ends her rock concerts with what feels to her apparently like a big epiphany when she ends by saying, love each other, so-and-sos, or something like that. But to her, it's sort of like, wow, now that I've told you this, our problems are going to be solved. All you got to do is love each other. And, you know, like, you read the Bible for a little while, you realize, oh, well, I'm for that. It's just a little harder than you make it sound, right? It's not easy to love each other. Usually when we look at God's law, which is what love each other is, the first thing we do is say, wow, this law is harder than I expected. This is why I need Jesus so much, right? When we're told to love each other, our first thought as Christians is, yeah, I need Jesus. I don't love anything like I should. There's no hope for me except for Jesus living and dying for me. We call that in the industry the second use of the law. It drives us to see our need of Jesus. We also talk about the third use of the law, which is the teaching use of the law, and that is for people who are converted Christians who've come into the faith. God's law becomes a description of who we're going to be, right? And more, you know, it doesn't seem like it a lot, but more and more we live into this picture of what real humanity is and what it means to be a person that lives with and pleases the Lord. And that's as we become people who love our neighbor more and more. And we're going to talk about the third use today. How in the world do we get at this? How do we become more loving in our lives when it's generally so hard for us? We do this with the Holy Spirit's help. But Paul adds some other thoughts to that in what he says in this little passage in Romans. So that's what we're going to think about today. Let me pray for us first, and then we'll read the scripture. Father, we ask for your help, that you'd let us understand and be penetrated by your word. Ask that you would open our hearts to us and let us open our hearts to you. And we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Read from Romans 13, beginning at verse 8, down through verse 14. Owe no one anything except to love each other. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment, are summed up in this word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of the law. Besides this, you know the time, that the hour has come for you to wake from sleep, for salvation is nearer to us now than when we first believed. The night is far gone, the day is at hand. So then, let us cast off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the daytime, not in orgies and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and sensuality, not in quarreling and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. This is the word of the Lord. It's absolutely true, and it's given to us because he loves us. I drove my wife's car over here. It's a Mini Cooper. It's not a car for a grown man. And it's also some combination of foreign. It's British and kind of German. I'm not sure what the mix is right now. But instead of words on the buttons in the car, they're pictures. And I don't see that well when I'm driving. I can't figure out how to unlock the door. I can't figure out how to do the windows and the lights. And, you know, so what I have to help me is an owner's manual. All right, it tells you what the buttons are, what the pictures mean. Yeah, sure. I've got contacts, Steve. Kind of. Oh. I know. Age is undefeated. I understand. So the owner's manual is pretty good. You know, it explains what all the buttons are and things. And that's helpful. Eventually get used to it. I also have something that matters to me a lot trying to drive around here that makes the button superfluous if I don't have it, and that is my app that shows maps, tells me where I am and where I'm going. You know, it's important to know what the buttons mean, how they work, and how to work the car, but it doesn't matter very much if you don't know where you are and where you're going. Right? And this fascinating illustration is meant to explain like two different ways of looking at ethics for a Christian. Like, about what does it mean to obey and do what you're supposed to do? On one hand, there's kind of a rule book approach to ethics that says, okay, let's take the Bible and let's distill out of it, kind of like, does anybody remember what the Knaves Topical Bible was back in the day? It basically organized the whole Bible by topic, which is interestingly not how God wrote the Bible for us, but it seemed like a good idea to do this, and it was a lot of work. But you can just distill out everything the Bible says about one certain ethical question, right? And then write all this down. Maybe you can have an index in the back that says everything you want to know about, you know, sexual ethics, or everything you want to know about property and theft. You know, here's this list. You can go look them up, distill it out. Here's the rule book. Do this, and you'll be okay. And there's not, that's not a bad thing to do. I mean, it is helpful a lot of times to like combine everything the Bible says about some ethical subject. But the other approach to ethics is to understand the story that you're in. It's like the map approach rather than the owner's manual approach. The map says this is who you are, and this is where you are, and this is where you're going. And this is who these other people are around you, and this is who God is. And you're going to need to live into that story if you're going to understand what love really looks like and means. The rules are going to matter, but apart from the story, the rules are really not going to give you the right idea of what does it mean to love people and what does it mean to love God and live into that. So think about it this way. Like when you think about Jesus talking about ethics, he's always telling stories, right? When someone asks him an ethical question, if he answers it directly, he's always kind of like, he's baiting people. It's like with the Good Samaritan story where, you know, the guy said, you know, what must I do to have eternal life? The guy, and he says, well, what do you think? He says, well, you know, keep the law, right? And Jesus says, okay. And you can tell he says it in a way that just baits the guy into asking another question, which he probably wishes he'd never asked. Like, love my neighbor, okay, who's my neighbor? And then Jesus tells them a story, basically saying, like, you're not wrong about the rules. You looked it up in the index, love your neighbor. Yeah, that was right. You get that right on the test. But if you don't understand the story, you're going to misconstrue it and distort it, right? And so that's what he does. I have two mentors. One is more like Jesus in that he answers with stories. You know, I'll ask him, like, what do you think about this church situation and what should I do? And he'll say, well, I remember in Hattiesburg, you know, many years ago, I'm like, what? Like, what do I do? I don't want a story. You know, and I've got another friend, he's from Minnesota, and you ask him what to do, and he says, oh, you need to fire that person. Like, very direct, here's the rule, do it, boom. You know, I always kind of think Jesus is the story person with ethics, and Paul, whom we're reading here, is the Minnesotan. You know, here's the facts, here's what you do. And he starts out that way in this passage. You know, he says, okay, look, here's the law. And he bumps him off. He mentions four of the second half of the Ten Commandments and then says, what other commandment, any other commandment, which feels like he was on a roll and he forgot. Right? Like someone somewhere has said. That makes me like Paul. But so he's giving you the didactic part. Here's the rules. You know, here are the commandments. Boom, 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 boom. But then Paul, you know, the practical person, goes into this flourish in the second paragraph and starts talking about the time, and how it's time to wake up from sleep, and salvation's nearer now, the night's far gone, day's at hand. And he starts saying things like, well, yeah, that's nice, but that's fluff, right? Get me back to the important stuff about, like, what do we do? I like the practical application, right? And he's basically pulling us back over to story. He's saying, yeah, hear the commandments, but if you don't understand the story, you're not gonna make good sense of the commandments, and they're not gonna be really fruitful in your life. And so he pushes us that way. And what's the story he tries to put us into? I guess the big picture of what Jesus is doing in the world. The world was created good. We rebelled against God and broke the world and broke ourselves. But we've been rescued by Jesus. He's come to our aid. Our older brother has come to find us and bring us back home, to forgive us, have mercy on us. Jesus has lived and died to reconcile us to God. So now here we are, Christians who aren't who we used to be, but sort of aren't who we're going to be yet at the same time. You've got these Venn diagrams that overlap, right? You're not who you were. You're now who you're going to be, but you're not fully who you're going to be yet. All right, so we live in that tension. Who are you really? You're a person who's on a pilgrimage to heaven, long journey home, but that's who you really are, the future you, not the past you. The past doesn't define you. The future defines you as a Christian. Right, who you're going to be. There's going to be a fixed version of you. It's going to amaze us all, right? But that's the story you're in. And so he's saying, pay attention to that story and don't live like the future isn't real and coming pretty fast. Live into that. Start living like who you're going to be. And that's kind of how Paul always talks about how to obey, right? You know, he says, you know, put off the old person and put on the new person. And he talks like that, and he uses the term flesh sometimes, like he does here, like in verse 14. When he says, put on the Lord Jesus Christ, that's how he says live as a new person, and make no provision for the flesh, which doesn't mean make no provision for your body. It means make no provision for who you used to be, body and soul, right? I had a roommate who took this to mean it was just your body. And every time he'd see you eating ice cream or something, he would say, make no provision for the flesh. Thankfully, he was wrong about what that means, right? Ice cream is good. But don't indulge who you were. You don't have to anymore, and you shouldn't, right? You can live who you're going to be, which is, of course, way more appealing to us anyway. But sometimes it feels really distant and hard to get to. But that's what he says. And here's the reason, because the law of God is very spare. You know, this doesn't tell us all that much. It gives us like guardrails on the outside of a wide thoroughfare and says kind of go that way. Don't go over the fences on either side. But man, there's a lot you have to know and decide and do and work out that's not just following the instruction manual, right? You know, the law is spare. You know, people say sometimes like they are dismissive of Christianity because they say, if I was the kind of person who just needed all the answers handed to me so I don't have to think, then maybe I would like that. And I'm like, where is that version of Christianity? Because that sounds good to me. I would love to not have to think so much and just follow the instructions, but that's not the Bible, right? The law is very spare. And there's a lot of need and room for wisdom and application of it and living out the motives of it, which are to love other people and to love God. So you got to have the story if you're going to understand what love means. And we've seen a lot of examples in the Bible, especially from the religious conservatives in the Gospels, where they were really serious and devoted trying to keep the rules and seeming to get it wrong at every point. Not because they were insincere or stupid, but because they disconnected the rules from the story in a way that caused them to distort it. So think about it this way. If someone's an alcoholic, you know, they have people in their lives, you know, usually a disappointed family who's been hurt over and over and over again by them. And in the disappointed family's eyes, they see an ethic that says you shouldn't drink to excess, and you shouldn't drink at all because you're addicted. And in that ethic, they look at you through the eyes of disappointment and exasperation. I'm like, oh, you know, is this how this is going to be? Another group that has the same ethic, you shouldn't drink to excess, and if you're an addict, you shouldn't drink at all. Same ethic. But this is an AA meeting, and they look at this person through eyes of commiseration and empathy. They all get together and tell the same stories to each other, right? Stories aren't interesting, but they matter because the story says, yeah, this is how it is. I know where you've been. I know where you are. You could still be lovable. You could still have hope of change. I'm looking at you with empathy rather than disappointment, right? Same ethic, different story. I'm not saying that to beat up on families of addicts. I know how hard that is, but I'm just saying it matters ethically what story you put yourself in if you're going to figure that out, all right? St. Augustine learned this and wrote a lot about it well. You know, he was a profligate and a professor, a Christian mother who's always worried about him. He moves to Milan, where he's a professor and is sleeping around, and he meets Ambrose, Bishop of Milan, and is very impressed and taken with him. They have a good connection. And you can tell Augustine is pretty much convinced that the Christian story is true. It just looks impossible to him. Like, he knows, like, but for me to accept this means I have to let God have the story rights to my life, and I don't know what that's going to mean, what he's going to do if I give my life over to him, but I'm pretty sure it's going to mess up my sex life. And I just can't imagine that because, you know, Augustine would say, he was deluded by a false story. He said, if I'm going to be happy and if I'm going to thrive, I have to do what I want to sexually. And so it seemed impossible to him to embrace this story so he could do what he's supposed to do sexually. And then, you know, the famous story of his conversion, he was out in the garden one day, vexed by all this, and he hears kids singing some song, Tole Lege, which he'd never heard of before, but some game they're playing, take up and read. So he goes inside, gets his Bible, does what you're not supposed to do, pops it open, pumps down his finger on Romans 13:13-14. And it says, let us walk properly as in the daytime, not in orgies and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and sensuality, not in quarreling and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. A verse I would never point to someone who is on the verge of converting. Like, this is what you need to read. God converts him, right? Boom. That's his verse. Like you may have a favorite verse, but there's no verse in the Bible that's going to be your verse. This is Augustine's verse, right? It's always going to be his verse. That's how God converted him. And when he began to speak so helpfully for all the centuries of Christian since and talking about what does it mean to live for Jesus and live with Jesus, he talked about story. Right? He said, our problem is not that we're breaking the rules so much as our problem is that our loves are disordered. Disordered loves that have to be changed. We have to learn to love what's lovable, love what's beautiful, love what's good. And that's way more story than it is a checklist of rules. He wasn't in any way resistant to the checklist of rules that the Scripture gives us, but he knows they have to be in the context of the story that God has put us in, or we're not going to understand them. Same thing with the Good Samaritan story, right? What Jesus said. He's not saying, the law about loving your neighbors yourself is insufficient. He said, no, that's the right law. But you got bigger problems than understanding what the right law is. And he tells them things. And so you read the Good Samaritan story, and you start learning some things. Like, first thing you learn is you should help the less fortunate. And everybody goes, you know, that's nice. We should help the less fortunate. That's good. That's just like Jesus to say something like that, isn't it? That's good. That's why people who are unfamiliar with the faith hear about the Good Samaritan, and they think, that's great. We should start an RV club and name it that. You know? But you start listening to what he's saying, and you start realizing, he's saying I've narrowed down who my neighbor is pretty badly, pretty meanly. That's a problem. Because there are a lot of people I don't like. And he says they're my neighbor. Story. Then he goes on and you think, wow, there's a pretty tremendous inertia in me about love. I would have told you before we had this conversation that I'm a nice and loving person. And after he tells me the Good Samaritan story, I'm thinking, well, I'm nice to some people. I'm nice to me and a couple of people I like, but I'm not a loving person on this kind of level. And then you start to say, wait a minute, I was identifying with the Samaritan, helping him in this story, and I think Jesus sees me as the one in the ditch, and he's a Samaritan. Huh. Well, that's different. And then eventually, Jesus wants me to see that he's the one in the ditch. He starts saying things like, if you've done it to the least of these, my brothers, you've done it to me. So now you've got a rule that's easy to understand that everybody quotes. Love one another. And then you got a story and you're like, oh boy, that's a whole different animal, isn't it? That's not just an easy rule to follow. That's a life-transforming revolution that has to happen in my life that has to be supernatural. The Holy Spirit of God has to come work in me if any of this is even going to start to happen. So Jesus told stories like that to keep people from treating the law like a rule book and thinking that they're going to square up ethically with God that way, right? So he says if you do everything right, but you don't have love, you're a clanging cymbal. And he doesn't. If you've been around church, like I've said this, I'm sure, and I've heard it and liked it, when people would say things like, well, when the Bible says love, it's not talking about an emotion. It's talking about doing what is required, what is your duty to other people. If you do your duty to other people, then you will have fulfilled the requirements of love. And I was like, yes, because I can probably fake my way through the duty, but I'm not going to have the affections and emotions for people. But that's not true, biblically. To love people is affectional. It's emotional. It is an emotion as well as a duty. Right? You're supposed to love people like Jesus loved you. Did Jesus just do his duty toward you and say, now I have fulfilled my obligation to you? Ugh. No, I mean, he loves you, and he says, you love your neighbor like I love you. How do you retrofit that into your life? How do you compel people to have affection for other people, especially people they don't like? I don't know, parents usually say something like, well, just do the right thing and your emotions will follow. Which, of course, isn't true, but it's something to say to your kids, you know. How do you compel love? The way you compel love is by getting stuck into a new story that makes you look at things differently. I'm the guy in the ditch. In this conversation that I'm in, I'm the screw up. I'm the one who needs the mercy of Jesus more than this other person does. I don't like that story, but that's the story Jesus is telling me about what it means to love my neighbor. What if he's like on the other side of the political aisle? What if it's a public figure on the other side of the political aisle? It's awful people that we hate and smash in our conversations and in our media. Is that my neighbor in a ditch? In whom I'm supposed to recognize Jesus, whom I'm supposed to think doesn't need Jesus' mercy quite as much as I do. That story's hard, right? That's a hard story to put yourself into, to think about what does it mean to love somebody else, right? What does it mean to love your neighbor as yourself? When people have a conversation with you, do they come away feeling more like they felt when they saw the empathetic eyes at the AA meeting? Or do they come away from conversation with you feeling mild disapproval? Because those are the tests of what love is for us. I mean, what Jesus ultimately says is the people that we have trouble loving, that we openly dislike, we are in their debt. He says in verse 8, owe no one anything except to love each other, For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. You owe love to your neighbor, even who is your political enemy. Which is hard, right? And if you're not steeping in the story, if you don't feel yourself as the one in the ditch, that's just never going to compute, right? You're never going to be able to look with mercy at other people that you despise unless you've gotten into the story. You're the one in the ditch. You're the one rescued by the older brother who's come to get the prodigal. Right? That's the only way that's going to happen. That's why Paul pushes us back to the story. He says, look, remember who you are, where you are in the process. You're on the way to being fixed by Jesus. Then he gives a couple of examples. He gives sex as the first example, and gives us really nuanced instruction and rule about sex, which is don't have orgies. So, like, if you're taking notes, write that down. Don't have orgies, because that's wrong, right? So it's very helpful to have that information, right? I'm sure you were unclear on that point until Paul says this now, right? So, but the difficulty for us with sex isn't the rules. We know what the rules are. It's just that we all have sex in a different story than God has it in. Right? We have it in the, this is for me. This is for my pleasure. This is for my gratification. This is for me to have what I want. God has it in a story that says, no, this is a way to give love. This is a metaphor of my love for you. And so it has a context that's going to matter a lot. You can't disconnect it from love like all pornography does and just a lot of objectifying sexual thought in our culture does. He says you can't cut the connection between sex and committed love. I mean, and like lifelong committed love, really committed love. Did you ever watch the cartoon Quick Straw McGraw? Remember his sidekick, the mule, I guess, Elka Bong? Elka Bong would, you know, solve crimes and crises by taking his guitar and using it as a weapon, an axe, right? Which worked in the cartoon, and might work maybe once if you had a guitar, but a guitar is really not a blunt instrument weapon to be used to smash people with. Right? It's a, not because don't like guitars, that's not what a guitar is. Sex, similarly, is not for self-gratification. It's for the expression and celebration of deeply committed love. Right? But if you got it in the wrong story, then you're going to be a mess with it. And so Paul gives these instructions this way. He's not squeamish about sex. He just says, you got to put it in the right story or you're not even going to know what it is. He uses the example of quarreling, too, verse 13. And his advice is don't. Don't quarrel. So don't quarrel, right? Write that down. You knew that. A friend of mine asked me the other day, though, he said, do you think there's any way forward in our cultural divides? And I, as the brilliant Christian witness, said, no, because I couldn't think of anything better. I wish I'd said, well, not without Jesus. You know, not without Jesus, because it's hard. Not supposed to quarrel. Going on vacation with any of your family this year? Y'all gonna talk about politics? Not if you want to have a happy vacation, right? Because we quarrel, and we quarrel not because we're confused about the ethics of quarreling. We know we're not supposed to quarrel, but we're in a story over here that says my politics and my cultural sensibility and my patriotism, my sense of what that means, is who I am. And I can't let it go if you challenge that, right? Yeah, I can't. The blood's coming to my face, and it's on if you bring it up, right? Because that's who I am. That's my story. And so Jesus, Paul says, don't quarrel. But he says, look, remember who you are. Do you remember who your real, the real you is? It's the future you, right? It's who you're going to be in the new creation. It's like, so you got to live into that story where your identity isn't your patriotism. Your identity isn't your nation. Your identity isn't your cultural view. Your identity is Jesus. You, as he says in verse 14, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. That's who you are. And the person who disagrees with you is not your enemy. It's a person who needs mercy. It's a person whom you're told to love like Jesus loved you, which is not to despise you for your bad views, but is to come to you in compassion and mercy and to love you. But if you don't get the story changed, lots of luck, right? Best you might be able to do is you might be the person that makes everybody change the subject when it starts getting bad. And that's the most you can hope for, which is not love or the law of love, right? So the story matters if you're going to ever live into what it means to love your neighbor as yourself. I did my daughter's wedding last year. It's something I said I'd never do because I'm an ugly crier. But, you know, it was COVID, which is so cheap. It was great. Like only 20 people could come to the wedding and half of them didn't drink. So, thank you, COVID. And I was happy about it. I mean, I like my new son-in-law. We have a saying in golf, though, there's a son-in-law shot. It's when you hit it and you think, well, it's okay. It's not quite what I wanted, right? So, I don't think he listens to my sermons. What would you tell your son-in-law if you're preaching the wedding sermon? I tried really not to say too much. I mean, you could say keep the rules, you know. There are some rules in the Bible about marriage, you know, how you're supposed to behave and some roles and things like that. What I wanted to say to him more, though, is there's a story you're in that's going to matter for your wedding way more than who does the dishes and who does the checkbook. And that story is that you're Christians. And you are marrying somebody that you think's awesome right now, but they are... I mean, usually the way you think about a wedding is this person looks fantastic now. They're very lovable right now. I'm going to try to just hold this picture in my mind as we manage the deterioration of years as it goes along and just think, well, they were lovely once, you know. But for a Christian, you're saying, okay, this is the raw, unfinished first draft. Because Jesus has invested in this person's life and has said, I'm going to complete the good work that I've begun in you until the resurrection. And so that means they're in a process that's a violent, ugly process that's going to involve a ton of failure, a ton of ugliness, a ton of them being who you hoped they'd never would never be. And you're going to have a front row seat for all of that. But what you're supposed to do is to invest yourself in the future person that they're going to be. Because Jesus is invested in that future person for them. He's not giving up on them. He thinks he can get them to heaven and fix them. You're supposed to be his advocate in that. You're going to jump in and you're going to be the encourager for your spouse. And when they're discouraged about who they are and what they've done, you're going to be the one who sees the future of them and says, I'm advocating for that. And I'm seeing that when you can't see it, and I'm going to keep on, right? I'm committed to who you're going to be. And come what may. That's why the vows are not, I'm so glad you're lovable right now, but I'm going to love you come what may. It's a different story. Right? It's a different story. I'm going to love you come what may. I don't think they listened to me. You know, they're just holding hands and giggly-eyed, but it was good stuff. So, story matters, right? You're not just told, go love people. You're told, you've been loved this way by Jesus. He came after you when you're in the ditch. He's still with you in the ditch. You've been loved this way. Future's coming. The night's about to end. Daylight's about to break. So love each other. Let's pray. Father, I wish it was easy to love. We've seen you love us, and we know it's an impossibly high bar. We pray that you would grant us the help of your Holy Spirit, deep roots into the grace of Jesus, deep feeling of how we've been loved, so that we might start to and get a little better at loving our neighbors ourselves. And we ask in Jesus' name, amen. Now let's stand and sing, "Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus." Seated. And now, please stand. I'm sorry. We prepare to come to the table. Yes, let's stand and confess our faith together using the Nicene Creed. Christians, what do you believe? We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again, according to the scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of God the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge the living and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And we believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now please be seated. And who said Southerners talk slowly? We come back repeatedly to the Lord's Supper because this is what Jesus wants us to regularly remember and engage in, is that he's merciful to us. He doesn't despise us, he doesn't hate us, he loves us and has come to our rescue. What he did on the cross, he did for our sake so that we could be forgiven and reconciled to God. So as you come with guilty consciences, maybe acute from something recent or maybe chronic, or something old, don't listen to the voice. Do this in remembrance of Jesus, that he loves you, that he hasn't despaired of you, that he's going to bring you to heaven. And he wants you at his table with him. If you're not already a convinced Christian, don't come take the Lord's Supper yet. Our order is that you come and be baptized into the church and receive Jesus Christ and then come to the table after that. So if you're in that journey, though, we'd love to talk with you or walk with you through it. So please speak up about it. If you're a Christian coming to the table, I want you to think about and feel the love that Jesus has for you, though. Right. Now let's pray. Let's pray using Thomas Cranmer's beautiful prayer from the Book of Common Prayer. We do not presume to come to this, your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord who delights in showing mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat this bread and drink this wine, that our bodies may be made clean by Christ's body and blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, for he is in us. Amen. On the night in which he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and having given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples. He said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Same way, Jesus also took the cup and gave it to his disciples and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. So drink from it, all of you. Now come and eat."
Thank you.
body of Christ given for you. Blood of Christ shed for you.
Do we have a song?
Prayer.
Oh, yeah, okay. I can handle that. For our pastoral prayer, that is our prayer of intercession, I'm going to begin with words from Daniel 2. Praise be to the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are His. He changes times and seasons. He sets up kings and disposes them. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the discerning. Creator Father, compassionate Son, the way you have ordered the universe is perfect, and we confess it, and we believe it. Now please help us to feel it. Help us to align our emotions with the way you are behaving, what you have decreed to be so. When you punish that which is sinful, you are just and righteous, we should rejoice. And when you reward that which you've transferred from sinful into beautiful and perfect, we should rejoice as well. Give us eyes to see and hearts to feel as you mold us and work in our lives. Dear Lord, we have many brothers and sisters in this membership that are hurting physically during recovery of health problems and or hurting emotionally through loss of loved ones, the health of loved ones, or their own health. More specifically, we are thankful that Karen is able to be with and a help to her ailing mother, and we ask as she does for her mother's salvation. May we also petition that Brother Paul be healed and that his spiritual awareness vastly increase and be applied to his life. We are thankful for the healthy lives of our young covenant children, Grace, Zeke, Lumen, Levi. Please change their hearts as soon, so that they will grow to be strong, mature Christian leaders. As fellow brothers and sisters, may we be reminded of our duties to continually search for ways to pray for, to comfort, and to support our fellow members in their distress. That is, to love one another as our Savior loved us, sacrificially. Please remind those in our body that are suffering to pray their cries to you, and please give them increasing faith to rely on your comforting promise that all things work together for good according to your purposes, and your purposes are always perfect. Father, for your elect living in the neighborhood of Desert Springs, particularly our new neighborhood on our west, as your truth is being preached here and taught here, we ask that you have them join us in praise and worship of you. Please give Pastor Steve, Amy, Jaden, Micah, Eli, and Asher a special blessing of wisdom during our pastor's sabbatical. Thank you for your recent blessing of rain, an answer to prayer on much of our area. We ask that this be a wet monsoon season. We take comfort in this pastoral prayer of praise and petition in the name of our Redeemer, Christ Jesus, and close with Isaiah 43's words of comfort. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. God of our fathers, please protect your remnant. Amen. Would you stand for our song of hope? May the peoples praise you.
Our glorious light, that we may sing the wonders of
And serve the Lord with these words of his love in our ears. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.
Amen.
You've probably seen most of the announcements. I heard you guys talking. There's no rehearsal this week?
That's correct.
Okay. Summer schedule, we already know that. Family Feast is next Sunday, June 26th. If you haven't signed up, please do so. And the normal monthly prayer meeting that Jeffrey will be leading, instead of being that Sunday night, will be right after the Family Feast. So rather than making two trips, especially for the Smiths. Remember the backpack and water bottles? Linda will take some money. Yeah. She knows how to wheel and deal with it.
For anything? The backpacks, okay.
Not for the shopping spree. Playground, as you know, phase one is complete. And as it says in the announcements, the new playground equipment has been installed and is open. And don't forget that we're still raising funds for the shade structure. Anybody have any other announcements? Have I forgotten anything? May we have our postlude.